الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تمسك بيده ودعا بدعوته أما بعد. Last lesson, which was Tuesday night, we were explaining the chapter of sacrifice and slaughtering. Sacrifices and slaughtering of the book of Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi rahimahullah, entitled Umdatul Fiqh, a book that we've given lessons from before in other places such as Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, about three summers ago. We explained the book of foods, much of the book of the Salah, and a few other issues. Also, in Masjid Taqwa, about 3 years ago, we explained the book of fasting from this book. It's a book that's similar to Durur al-Bahiyyah, but different. Similar and different. So we were speaking, or we were saying that we wanted to talk about the Udhiyyah and Eid al-Adha. And before we get into that specifically, we have to understand the basics of slaughtering in Islam. What are the conditions for a valid Islamic sacrifice? How do you kill an animal? Whether it's used for udhiyah or whether it's used for just eating, hunting an animal, etc. So we explain all of this on Tuesday's lesson. Who can remind us of what we spoke on briefly? Abu Sa'id?
Three
types of slaughter, which are? Nahar, Dhabih, and Aqr, Ascent. We said that there is Nahar, Dhabih, and Aqr. What does the word Aqr mean? What does Allah Azza wa Jal say? قَالَ لَهُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ نَاقَةُ اللَّهِ وَسُقِيَاهَا فَكَذَّبُوهُ What's the verse? فَأَقَرُوهَا They slayed the she-cam of Salih. طيب. That's aqr. Is to do what? It's to kill an animal that is relatively domestic, but it runs loose and it gets free and it flees, and you cut it in its leg or in its back, and then it dies off, You do what you can. Then we said that the dhabh is cutting across, and the nahar was poking and twisting, and that is mainly specific to camels. It's permissible, according to the author, to make dhabh and nahar of camels and sheep and goat. And also, we're not necessarily getting into chickens, even though slaughtering a chicken or a fowl is also the same rulings. But we're speaking specifically about the Udhiyyah and also generally about slaughtering as a whole. طيب. خير inshallah. What else did we talk about? Imran? The requirements for a correct slaughter. If you do not fulfill these requirements, according to Ibn Qudama, then your sacrifice is unlawful. Your animal is unlawful to be eaten. It's not shar'iyya. It's meta. It's carrion. Tayyib. What else did we mention? Follow them. That you can use any sharp object as long as it's not a claw or fang, a tooth or a nail, whether it's wood, metal, glass, steel, stone, anything that's extremely sharp. Tayyib, what else did we talk about? Hunting. What did we say about hunting?
Whether it's weapons or animals.
Tayyib, different types of hunting. Khair inshallah. What else did we talk about? Khalid. The weapon has to pierce the skin, pierce the flesh. You cannot hunt with weight or something that's cumbersome. You can't hurl a rock at it. You cannot use a what? Boomerang. You cannot use a slingshot or something that's blunt. It has to be something that what? Pierces and spills blood. Right. What else do we explain? Abu Sa'id. Both men and women are allowed to make dhabh. And those who say that a woman cannot slaughter must bring their proof from the Kitab and the Sunnah or remain silent. Tayyib. The Hakim. Huh? What about them? What are the qualifications of the one who slaughters? Number one, they have to be a... Starting off, so from the beginning, we said what? They have to be what? La, before Muslim. They have to be sane. If they're not sane, if they're crazy, the slaughter is invalid. Number two, they have to be physically able, physically capable. Qadiran. Number three, either Muslim or Kitabi. Number four, that's it. That's all we mentioned about the slaughterer. Tayyib? Hayden, inshallah. What else do we talk about before we move on? Naam, those who are mute should look towards this sama, according to the author, Asanta. Very good. Anyone else? Allah's name has to be mentioned at the time of slaughtering or sending your weapon for hunting. Before you squeeze the trigger, a crossbow, huh? Before you release the bow, according to how you hold it. Huh? Tahir, khair inshallah. What else?
If you're for a doctor, say this and that.
In hunting or slaughtering?
Both.
La, the author mentioned a difference. He says hunting, if you forget one slaughtering, then the valid, it is still what?
Valid.
If you forget when you hunt?
No.
Arab, and there's a reason why he said that, based off of the hadith. Tahir, anybody else? Nasif. What else do we mention? Nahyan. Suhail, Darfur, ah, anybody else?
The crabs and,
that according to the author, crabs are permissible to eat. You have to make them of a crab.
I mean, you gotta cut the. There's no blood, something like that. It's halal, sorry. I'll take it back.
Got it. Things without blood that live where? In and out. Amphibious animals without water. Did we say this? Something that's amphibious and it lives? Guy, what else do we mention? What about the sea animals or sea creatures? All of them are halal according to the author. What does the word bahar mean? We said a large body of water. A very large what? Body of water. Not necessarily something that is salty. There's a big difference between fresh and aywa, big difference. Like, what else? Everything on land has to be slaughtered. No exclusion to that, except for? Huh?
Locusts.
And grasshoppers, asant. Tayyib. What else? Okay, that's good. Good workout. Asantum. Jazakumullah khair. Very good job. Khalid. We want you to find for us the chapter of slaughters in Sunan Abi Dawood. Abu Sa'id, please read for us from the Muwatta. Yalla.
What is meant by Dafa is a group of eating people having come to Medina.
No, we read that, Sheikh. Moving on. Now continue.
Offered him meat, and he said, verify whether this meat is from that sacrifice or not. They said, it is from it. Abu Sa'id asked, has not Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbidden it? They replied, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has ordained a new command since he went away. Then Abu Sa'id quickly went out asking about that. When he was told that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I have already forbidden you from eating the meat of sacrifices. After the lives of 3 days, so eat of it, give some to charity, store away some of it, and I have forbidden you from making wine, but now you are permitted to
make it. Now, next hadith.
Chapter 5, sacrifice, sharing, and the number of persons for which a cow or camel is slaughtered.
Sorry.
Definitely I narrated from Malik, who is Shubair and Mekhi, who Jabir, Ben Abdullah, who was Anbu, Rahimahullah, who said in the year of Udhiyyah, which is the Treaty of Reconciliation, we slaughtered a camel for each 7 persons of Allah, with Allah's Messenger,
sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
And a cow for each 7 ones.
So that's the deed, that 7 people can come together and slaughter a cow or a camel. Khairan, inshallah. That's the proof. That's the delay for that. Right? So if this hadith is authentic in the Muwatta of Malik, and we've said before that the Muwatta of Malik is one of the most authentic books of hadith. One of the most genuine books of prophetic traditions. No one can come and say, any madhab say, you can't come together and share a cow or a camel. Because there's a clear hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that has not been abrogated. It has not been abrogated. Tayyib, tafadhol. Abu Ayyub al-Ansari says, we used to, yani, in the time of the Rasul. We used to. In other words, that which was well known by the Prophet, that which was practiced. A man would slaughter a sheep for himself and for his family. Fire. Madhab of Malik. So the book of Hadith and Fiqh. That's his opinion that you should not come together upon 7. Why? Why does he say this? It's another reason why. Right, next narration. Fadal. Next narration.
Yahya narrated from Malik and Ibn
Shihab.
Sacrifice nothing but a camel or a cow for himself and on behalf of his household. Malik said, I do not know whichever of them. Ibn Shihab said,
next hadith.
Sacrificing for the woman's fetus and mentioning the days of
Tah, khair. Khalid. Tafadhol, you got it? You have nothing yet? Imran, go find the chapter of slaughtering or sacrifices in the English translation of Sunan Abi Dawood. Alright, let's get started our class tonight when we wait for Imran. The author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, Faslun fi shurut al-dhaka. Ishtaratu fi al-dhabhi wa nahri khasatan sharatan. Ahaduhuma an yakuna fi al-halqi wal-lubba fayaqta' al-hulquma wal-mari وما لا تبقى الحياة مع قطعه الثاني أن يكون في المذبوح حياة يذهبها الذبح فإن لم يكن فيه إلا كحياة المذبوح وما أبينت حشوته بالذبح ولا النحر وإن لم يكن كذلك حل لما روى كعب قال كانت لنا غنم ترعى بسلع فأبصرت جارية لنا شاة موتى فكسرت حجرا فذبحتها به فسئل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن ذلك فأمر بأكلها. The author, someone's phone is ringing up here as well. Excuse me. Someone's phone is ringing. Brothers, next time if you want to record the class, please put your phone on airplane mode. Inshallah. Right. Now we're going to read some explanation of this metin, because last night or Tuesday night we just really translated it and broke it down, analyzed it, the actual linguistics of the text. And the book that we're going to read from is called Sharh Umdatul Fiqh, the explanation of Umdatul Fiqh. And the author is named Dr. Abdullah ibn Abdul Aziz Al Jibreen, who is a professor in the University of Abd al Malik Saud in Riyadh. The author, Ibn Qudama, we said, who died many, many years ago, he says, Bab al-Dhaka. He now speaks about the chapter of Imran. Let us know how you're doing, because we want to read those hadith before we get started on this. Khalid, you go back there and help him. Miss Khalid, you keep looking in there. You got it? Hi. Please read. Excuse me?
What chapter?
Question says, what would they use? We say, to research and to look for things in an actual book, a tablet, even on Google, online. It takes skill and knowledge. And a very important tool to get and skill to obtain is to learn how to find things. Learn how to do what? Just like a detective at a crime scene. He's been trained, he's been educated, let alone with his natural talent, his intuition, to look for things, to find things, to discover things that the normal naked eye would never ever think about. The average police, special detective, they're trained to find things. And similarly, as a student of hadith, you think it's easy to just pick up an index? It's not that simple. The word khala they could use, I'm not going to tell you specifically what Abu Dawood says, but you may read Kitab al-Adahi. It may be in the actual book of foods, Kitab al-At'ima. It may be in the book of Hajj and Umrah. Naam? Everybody clear on this? Adha, several different words, as we mentioned some of them. Nahar, Aqar, Dhab, etc. Foods, Dahaya, perhaps, plural of Udhiyyah, or Dahiyyah, excuse me, plural of Dahiyyah. Clear on this? So, before you move on, we say, Imran, Khalid, when I send you to look for something, it's not to waste time or to fill time, but it's a benefit. When you look through an index of a book, you learn things. If you don't use the index and you search for the book itself, you learn even more. But that's a whole nother concept we don't want to get into right now. Khayrin, inshallah. The author, he says, Rahimahullah Ta'ala, Ibn Qudama, in the beginning of the chapter, باب الذكاء الذكاء ذبح أو نحر الحيوان البري المأكول وعقر الممتنع من وقد اتفق أهل العلم على أن محل الذكاء للحيوان المقدور عليه والحلق واللبة وعلى أنه لا يجوز الذبح في غير هذا الموضع. He says, the word ذكاء, if you want to know what it means in Arabic, write it down, is to slaughter, is to make ذبح or نحر of a land animal whose flesh is lawful to eat, or to slay wild, rebellious land animals. Al-Dhaka is two things, dhabih or nahar. Of what? He says, al-hayawan al-barri, a land animal. So there is no dhabih, there is no nahar of a sea animal, ahsant. There is no nahar or no dhabh of a or of an amphibian. For example, he says what? Al-hayawan al-barri, land animal. The next description is, he says, al-ma'kool, which can be eaten. So something which is unlawful to be eaten, even if you slaughter it properly, it is also, it's not the legislative way of what? Slaughtering. He then says, and or nafis, and or وَعَقْرُ الْمُمْتَنِعِ مِنْهُ, and to slay an animal that refuses to be slaughtered. As we said before, the animal runs away, we started the sacrifice and then broke free. We didn't finish it, we didn't cut it from ear to ear, and then broke free, but when we got it, it was dead. Everybody understand this? Everybody clear on this? An animal that refuses to be slaughtered, it's mumtani', says, no, you're not killing me today. I'm not gonna be lamb chops tonight. And many animals, there's no doubt, when you go to the slaughterhouse, are very rebellious. There's no doubt about that. Khair, inshallah, moving on. He then says, the people of knowledge agree that the place for which the slaughtering is to be made for an animal that is docile or at least domesticated, two things, the halq and the lubba. And the halq basically means, there's several ways to translate it, it's very important, is basically the entire neck or the throat. Cutting across, what has to be cut? The esophagus, the veins on the side, jugular veins, the glottis, the windpipe, but these things are what? At least it's the ish, the neck. And if not, then the what? Aywa, of the camel, or vice versa. He says, and it's impermissible to slaughter in any of these two places with regards to an animal that is being slaughtered. If it runs away, if it's wild, that's a different what? Everybody clear on this? It's a different what? It's a different issue. But the animal that you have control of, it's tied up, you've placed it on the ground, you cannot stab it in its belly and say Bismillah Allah Akbar. You cannot cut off its leg and say Bismillah Allah Akbar. The sacrificial slaughter is only in these two. Everybody clear on this point? And he says this is ijma. There's no difference of opinion among the ulama with regards to these two points. Everybody clear on this? Everybody clear on these words? He then says, commenting on what Ibn Qudama said, يُبَاحُ كُلُّ مَا فِي الْبَحْرِ بِغَيْرِ ذَكَاتٍ يَقَوْلِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فِي الْبَحْرِ الْحِلُّ مَيْتَتُهُ. He says here, everything which is in the sea is lawful to be eaten without any need for sacrifice. And this is due to what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said concerning the Bahar, its dead game is lawful. The explainer says, وَهَذَا مُجْمَعٌ عَلَيْهِ فِي الْجُمْلَةِ. He says, the ulama agree on this in general. An animal, or you say, something that comes out of the sea, it does not need it to be what? It doesn't need to be slaughtered. However, there are some small issues in which they differ over, such as if the animal dies by itself, if it's floating. In other words, you take a fish out of the water, you don't have to slaughter it. It flaps until it dies. But some ulama, they say if the fish, you find it floating by itself, it's no longer living, then they say you can't. There's no slaughter, period. You say you can't what? You can't eat it at all. Everybody got this? Everybody clear on this? Very simple concept. You have a fish, call it Baisley Pond. You take the fish out of the water, the fish bites, the hook takes the bait. What does the fish do? Violently, vigorously, say? Now you grab a fish, or you see a fish floating, a big fish, and it's floating, it's buoyant. You take it out of the water. It doesn't smell bad, it doesn't look bad, but it's dead. Is it permissible to eat that fish? We didn't say that. Some ulama, not the author, no. The explainer, he said that the author said everything. Ibn Qudama said everything out of the Bahar is lawful to be eaten without slaughter. Kullu shay. Kullu shay. Everything out of the Bahar. Everybody clear on this? According to the author. Everything out of the sea, or out of a large body of water, is lawful to be eaten according to Ibn Qudama, rahimahullah ta'ala. Now, the explainer, the doctor, he says, in general, the ulama, they agree on this. And there's some small issues that they differ on these sea creatures, such as maybe a snake, shrimp, crab, things like this, or even a fish or type of sea animal that is what? floating. It's what? Floating. Everybody clear on this? And the most correct opinion is that everything that comes out of the sea is lawful to be eaten as long as it is not poisonous or harmful. Everything. Every creature out of the water is lawful to be eaten. Dead, alive, floating, moving, shell, soft body, as long as it is not poisonous and as long as it does not cause bodily harm. That is the qawl sahih that is supported by the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Moving on. He then quotes, or we'll mention a statement of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal rahimahullah, which he says, "السمك الذي نبذه البحر لم يختلف فيه وإنما اختلفوا في الطافي." Imam Ahmad said, "A fish that is cast out of the sea," he says, "none of the ulama differ over this, but they only differed over the thing that is طافي, floating. In most cases, they may say that if it's floating, something is wrong with the fish. It's harmful, it's dead, it was poisoned. Rather, there is a hadith that states, narrated by Jabir ibn Abdullah, that you cannot eat the fish that is tafi. And the hadith is weak, it's not sahih, and we do not contradict the authentic hadith with da'if hadith. Everybody clear on this? Moving on. Next point. The author says, "Illa ma ya'ishu fil bar min haywan al bahr kis-sulhufa والسمندل والفقمة ونحوها فلا يباح حتى يذكى لأنه حيوان يعيش في البر وله دم يسيل فلم يباح بغير ذكاة كالطير البحري." He then says, Ibn Qudama, the next point of the matin, "Except for that which lives on land." Except for that which lives on land. The explainer says, in other words, the sea creature that lives on land, which is an amphibian. The sea creature, which what? Lives on land. Everybody got this? We're done with the sea creatures. That's done. Finished. He then makes an exclusion. Everything in the sea is permissible to eat except for an animal out of the sea that comes on land. The explainer says, such as turtles, salamanders, things like this. Ibn Qudama says, it is unlawful for these things to be eaten until they are slaughtered. As we explained last night, the author, he says, and the reason behind this is because it lives on land and it has blood that flows. It has what? Blood that flows. The next point that we spoke about last night was what? No question. Ascent. That was point three. Everybody got this? If it lives in the water, if we wanted to simplify, it is what? Permissible, according to the author. Huh? Yes, doesn't need to be slaughtered. If it comes out of the water and goes on land, then it is divided into how many categories? Two. The first is the category of those that have, and the second of those who don't have blood. Or it says blood that flows, because a fly has blood. You smash a fly, it has somewhat, some type of blood, but it's not pouring. Everybody clear on this? Crab doesn't have what? Everybody clear on this? Wallah, clear? Quiet. So if the animal comes out of the water on land, if it has blood, then you do what? Slaughter it. If it doesn't have blood, ascent. Does not need to be slaughtered. Clear? Everybody clear on this? He then says, كَالطَيْرِ الْبَحْرِ. He makes an example of this, the explainer, such as a bird that also goes into water. Such as a seabird, quote unquote. A bird that goes where? And it also goes on land. It flies and it lands and goes back and forth. Everybody clear on this? He then says, إِلَّا السَّرَطَانُ وَرَحْرُهُ مِمَّا يَعِيشُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحَرِ وَلَيْسَ لَهُ دَمٌ يَسِيلُ إِذَا ذُبِحْ فَهُوَ مِمَّا يَحِلُّ أَكْلُهُ بِغَيْرِ ذَكَاتٍ لِأَنَّ مَقْصُودَ الذَّبْحِ إِنَّمَا هُوَ إِخْرَاجُ الدَّمِ مِنَ الْحَيَوَانِ وَتَطْيِيبُ اللَّحْمِ بِإِزَالَةِ الدَّمِ عَنْهُ فَمَا لَا دَمَ لَهُ لَا حَاجَةَ إِلَى ذَبْحِهِ فَذَكَاتُهُ أَنْ يُفْعَلَ بِهِ مَا يَمُوتُ بِهِ. Then talks about the crabs. The reason why you do not have to slaughter crabs and things like crabs because they don't have pouring blood. The entire purpose of the slaughter is to two things. It's to pour out the blood, and secondly is to, he says, تَطْيِيبُ اللَّحْمُ. It's to purify the meat. To make sure the meat is good and clean without no type of blood, poison, or whatever else from the blood. The lahm is pure, it's fresh. There's nothing in it. It's not like an animal that's scared, that's afraid, that's hitting the head. The blood remains where? Inside of the veins and arteries, the capillaries, huh? And it's inside of the meat. So the animal that is cut, the blood does what? Profusely. Pours out what? Profusely. Everybody clear on this? That is the hikmah why you do not have to slaughter crabs and why it's lawful to eat them according to the author. Everybody clear on this? Next point. He then says, or moving on to the explanation, he says, as for the things that have no point blood, then the only thing you have to do to them is something which causes them to die. That's it. Whether it's boiling them, leaving them out of the water without oxygen, or whatever the case may be. Everybody clear on this? Everybody clear? Moving on, he says, وَلَا يُبَاحُ حَيَوَانَ الْبَرِّ شَيْءٌ بِغَيْرِ ذَكَاتٍ لَأَنَّ غَيْرَ الْمُذَكَّى مِنَ الْحَيَوَانِ الْبَرِّ مَيْتَةٌ وَلَا يَجُوزُ أَكْلُهُ لِقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ إِلَى قَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى إِلَّا مَا ذَكَّيْتُمْ وَهَذَا لَا خِلَافَ فِيهِ. The next point that Ibn Qudama mentioned was nothing from land animals, no type of land animals are lawful to be eaten unless they are slaughtered. The explainer says that is because a land animal which is not slaughtered is considered to be meita. It's what? Meita, which is translated into English as not even dead. La, when you slaughtered it, what is it? So that can't be it. You can't say dead. Once you kill it, it's also dead. Al-meita legislatively means ma lam talhaqhu zakatun shar'iyyah. Is any animal that is not slaughtered properly. Any animal that isn't what? Slaughtered properly. Shooting? We explained that. You missed the class, Jake.
Yeah.
You gotta get the recording. Hunting, we mentioned in brief, and we'll go over it again in the future, that hunting is what? It's permissible. As long as the animal that is to be hunted. You can't hunt a cow that you can slaughter. You can't hunt a lamb that can be slaughtered. But the animal that's too fast, too clever, too cunning, huh? Then it's permissible for you to hunt it with the conditions of hunting, even if it's with a bullet. As long as that bullet does what? Pierces the body and pours out blood. Everybody clear on this? Moving on. The author, he says, Abu Sa'id, we said what? Any animal that is not slaughtered properly is called